There we go. So we are talking with Mike Tramp, who's currently on tour in the U.S. How is that going these days?
Well, it's going great. I hadn't thought maybe like a year ago that I would end up here doing what I'm doing right now. But when I went into the studio a year ago to record Cobblestone Street,
right,
it was really just going into my friend's studio just to record some songs because I needed to hear new, fresh music out of the speakers. Right. I didn't really know what direction I was going or whatever. And a week later, I came out with a finished album without thinking that I'd done anything different than just going in there and recording some songs to listen to. And then as I sat and listened to it and basically just heard the or listened to my roots and memories of where I come from and stuff like that, not just lyrically, but more sonically, because I grew up in the late 60s on a lot of folk music, because in Denmark at that time, along with the Vietnam War protests and you know, Dylan's, you know, presence on the stage, Neil Young, et cetera, et cetera, there were a lot of Danish artists of the same kind. And, you know, it's just sort of one of the things that attached itself to me. I didn't realize it, but later on, it was obvious to me that that is my foundation in songwriting.
Right.
And White Lion songs come from that same point that is, which is why it's easy for me to go out there these days and do these songs. I'm not trying to reproduce the electric version. I'm trying to sort of play, you know, the foundation of where the song came from.
Right. So, I mean, the tour is an acoustic tour, right?
Yeah. I mean, in lack of better words, it's only me. So,
right.
And this is what it's been for the last year and a half. I've now done over 150 shows in Europe and basically just driving out there in my own car and delivering the music. But also, you know, telling the story and getting a better chance to show those who have followed me and those who care where it is I come from and who it is that I am, you know, because a lot of time during the 80s, and when you look back, you're sort of completely covered and shielded by an image, and it seems all kind of like Mickey Mouse artificial.
Right.
And completely, there's no way that this could ever have continued. I know that there are bands that still today, 35, 40 years later, are putting the same costumes on and makeup and stuff like that. But when you're not that type of person,
right,
you have to follow what is natural to me. And I see myself more as a sculptor or a painter that simply does something because he loves to do it. And then when other people say the same thing about it, then, you know, it comes down to that. It's a double winner here.
Yeah. And you know, you mentioned that you wanted to hear new music. You know, in the world today with the YouTube and the internet and all this wonderful downloading, why bother making a new album? Why not just go out and play the hits? You could do it. People would come to the shows anyway.
Yeah, but I'm not wanting to play the hits.
They
sort of just fits into the songs because I'm not on the road because I'm desperate to feel the that vibe of being around, you know, fans and the club or living that kind of rock star dream. I mean, I just came back from Sears where I bought a Tool because it reminded me, you know, about how I lived in America when I lived there, where music still was something that I did and White Lion was still something I did. But when I was home, I was sort of a real and average person that's kind of likes to do stuff that is connected to the earth. If it's repairing your car or fixing the gutter in your house or stuff like that, I can't hide what I am.
Right.
And I think the only reason which I've been absent for quite a few years here and there is that with this music made me feel a fall back in love with music again, that I wanted to go out and tour. So that's sort of what it's really about. Cobblestone Street is what brought me out to play these songs and then say, oh, okay, here is something that makes sense. And when I'm finished with the show and when I wake up the next day, I've never felt so rewarded in my life as an artist doing this. And, you know, a lot of people would maybe say, oh, okay, but you're not playing the big stages, you're not making a lot of money, and you're not selling a lot of records. And those are the ones that think that that is what it's about, you know, but that's not where my tram comes from. And I know there's a lot of other people who feel the same way. I remember the story of the painter in the old days that painted a picture and then nobody could understand why he didn't want to sell it. He says, well, I did it for myself.
Yeah. So then what is the future for Mike Tramp then? Are you going to do more? Now, here's the album cover for people to see. Are you going to do more albums like Cobblestone Street? Or are you going to go back into a rock band situation with drums and guitar and the whole thing?
No, I'm never going to go back in that way. I am already planning on recording the new album, or start recording the new album when I tour in Denmark in October and November in between the shows. And I'm simply just going to let the music speak for itself as I go into the studio. I'm not doing a lot of preparation and things like that. I have the songs, and I want to just see what happens when I go in there and so on. So I have said that if it is that I wanted and I needed to feel the power of the big guitars and the loud drums, I think it would be more under a project name.
Okay.
So you don't see, you know, like the band photo with five guys with folded arms, you know, and Affliction t-shirts and stuff like that. And now here I got to do the interviews again. And, you know, because I already know, both as an artist and also as somebody who's been in the business for 37 years, that there's no way that I can tour with a band and afford it,
right?
You know, or pay everybody. There's just not enough money in it. So, but of course I have the love for power rock and so on. So, you know, and which is also one of the reasons why sort of the project, the Rock and Roll Circus exists. This was a solo album that I went into the studio to do with my friends, but they just had too much influence on the plan. And it did not sound like a solo artist recording this,
right,
which is why I sort of added the Rock and Roll Circus, just kind of to put that in a box and also to pay credit to them. And a thing like that could happen. I've been offered by a lot of different people these kind of new projects where maybe just be involved with one album. Of course, I know that there's no market for touring with a band and four road crews and a road manager and possibly a bus. I know what it costs. It is impossible. But what's possible is Mike Tramp jumping in a car with his acoustic guitar and a couple of T-shirts and CDs and then going around the world.
Yeah, and is that disappointing that you can't do the whole touring thing, or is this sort of more refreshing to be able to just rely just on yourself? Because you can't hide behind a band. It's you.
Yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying. You know, a lot of people would think it is, but why is it that I'm really enjoying sitting by myself in the car for like 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 hours sometimes just listening to audiobooks and then saying, I just love being alone and stuff like that, because it's again one of those things to find somebody who wants to stop when you want to stop, who needs to go in the toilet when you need to go in the toilet, who wants to eat when you want to eat, and who wants to listen to what you want to listen. So it's just, I know what works for me, and that reflects in how I walk on stage and what I deliver to the people. And right now, the album and the live reviews are unanimous. It's almost 99%. Everybody hears the same, sees the same, and feels the same.
Yeah. Now, let me talk
a
little bit.
That's never happened before.
No, absolutely not. Let me talk a little bit about some life changes, and correct me if I'm wrong. When White Line was going full force, you lived out in the States. Afterwards, you moved over to Indonesia. Now you're back in Denmark. How does it feel to sort of go back home and you know?
Well, it sort of actually became a little bit of a longer journey in reality. Okay. I mean, first I moved with my first wife and my son to Australia.
Right. Nice
and,
country.
And I was kind of like just giving myself some time to kind of like feel it out of what it was. And obviously from that came both recovering the wasted years and more to life than this. Those were both, you know, written and kind of like prepared in Tasmania, Australia, where I lived. When my marriage then kind of ended after 16 years and I fell straight into the arms of another woman and got married in Indonesia, it's been a little bit of a Bermuda Triangle between, you know, Copenhagen, Denmark, and Jakarta, Indonesia, and Melbourne, Australia, where my oldest son lived. And it's a bit of a homeless kind of like state of mind right now. And I'm not quite comfortable in that because I'm still searching for that final home and that final resting place where I'm saying I ain't moving anymore now.
Yeah.
And I haven't been able to find that right now. I'm still working out. You know, I'm also raising, you know, two younger children. My son Lennon is 4.5. My daughter Isabel is 7.5. They're born in Los Angeles and born in Copenhagen, but right now they're being sort of raised in Indonesia. And there's just a lot of loose ends right now. It's not, like I said, this ain't the life I asked for, but it's what I got. And it's what I've become. So I just have to do the best I can under the circumstances. And, you know, sometimes I'm away and sometimes I'm not.
Yeah, but it did seem to me that you sort of part of rediscovering yourself as an artist was sort of going back to Copenhagen sort of going back.
Exactly, and that's probably also besides, you know, the reward in music, that is the true reward that I've gotten through my long journey on the endless highway, is that I didn't just discover this yesterday, but over the past 10 years, I have stepped back into the shoes of the real Mike Tramp and who I am and following my heart and not listening to anyone, because it is an incredible, painful experience doing something that you don't want to do and then failing with it.
Right.
So once you follow your heart, you can't fail, because you just do what's most natural, and that is just who I am.
Right.
And I can't, I mean, and you know, I mean, when I dissect the career in White Lion and the years in White Lion, I do see the traces in so many different places. Touring with Kiss, I wanted to travel with the truck drivers because I wanted to see the country. I wanted to see something else. Touring with AC/DC, I always wanted to come early because I want to hang with their road crew and seeing the stage being built and stuff like that. And it's almost like that 45-minute performance that I did was so small in the big picture.
Right.
That I was connected to something else. I was connected to the earth. Then you look at the lyrics, and you look at "Cry for Freedom," "Little Fighter," "Broken Home."
Great song.
All these different things, and that's really just the reflection of my tramp, the kid that was born in Denmark, grown up with an awareness of the world and situations, different places. And I was just never good at playing the game of vertical smile, slipping her the big one, and look what the cat dragged in kind of thing. Those were somebody else. I never really fitted that. You know, I don't remember standing or playing in between, sandwiched in between Motley Crue and Skid Row, and trying to go out to like 25,000 people and educate them, and failing, and just realize, okay, I understand. I'm not fit for this. Not fit for this poker or for this bill. You know?
This bill. Was the whole sort of contrived image of the 80s difficult for you to take then?
Well, I mean, I'm not going to lie. Of course, I wanted to. From the second I saw David Roth, and especially when the time watched him on TV in Spain, and he had just, you know, dyed his hair blonde, and he was bigger than life, bigger than God, bigger than anything. It's everything that I wanted. And I guess in reality, that was just that period. It became the ticket. It became the rocket up my ass to drive me towards what White Lion became, and never saying never and never giving up and full going it. But then, like I said, it's like once I climbed into the tight pants and the 50,000 colorful jackets and the hair and stuff like that, there were also suddenly the other conscience on my shoulder just saying, hey, but you're also something else. So, you know, I in reality had to run that gauntlet and go with it till it sort of wore itself out, et cetera, et cetera. And the closing of White Lion, there are several reasons why the band broke up. But I do think also that you sort of can hear my tram changing drastically right. on the final album, hence Freak of Nature.
Yeah, that, I was going to say that was a completely different image. I mean, it was sort of almost rejecting what White Lion was and saying, here's this sort of more metal, more dirty, more scruffy looking kind of band and band image.
Yeah, sure. I mean, of course, if you use the analogy of a pizza pie and stuff right. like that, then of course there is a slice that is called influence of the present time, which of course at that time was
the grunge.
You know, Nirvana, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden. Then there's a slice called influence of the classic rock background, which we all came from: Thin Lizzy, UFO, all those bands, you know, early Whitesnake, et cetera, et cetera. And then there is, you know, the slice that's called returning to your roots of being back down on the ground. And the slice that's called when I play in the band, I want to be together with my brothers. I want to hang with them before rehearsal. I want to enjoy rehearsal. And after rehearsal, I want to go have a beer with them.
Right.
That is a completely total opposite of White Lion and Mike Tramp and Vito Bratis' relationship. We had zero relationship, zero, except for writing songs and playing on stage.
Yeah.
So in many ways, Freak of Nature became all those things, you know, returning to how I was under the impression. And a friend of mine was reminding me about it yesterday. He says, well, you know, the story I read about you coming from that Danish band Mabel, that you guys lived together, you grew up together, sort of, and always were together. You were under the impression that when you're playing in a band and when you're with your friends, you're always together. And that always was my interpretation of White Lion. But it never happened that way. So when we ran into trouble or stuff like that, let's say, for example, the confusion we ended up with going in to record Big Game, coming off 2 years of touring with AC/DC, Aerosmith, Kiss, Stryper, Japan, Europe, etc. You know, not the bands, but the countries. The band were divided and could not sit down and regroup. It was the football team of all stars that didn't know their place. Everybody was, you know, the center in that way. And so all those different things helps breaking it up and stuff like that. And it was everything I didn't want Freak of Nature to be. I wanted to fall back in love with playing music. And I did that with Freak of Nature.
Okay.
And now, once again, I have been completely, you know, revived, you know, and reborn with Cobblestone Street and found my place. And in reality, also, without making it gloomy, preparing myself for my next chapter, maybe my last chapter in music, doing something that I think that I will be capable of doing in 10 years, too.
Right.
I'm not out there trying to sing something I can't do. I'm not trying to squeeze into an outfit that looks ridiculous in this day and age, at least in my view, you know?
Let me ask you.
Really just following myself.
You just mentioned being able to do it. You said you can do. As a singer, you know, as we get older, things start falling apart on us, our shoulders, our legs. Do you have any issues with your vocal cords? Or are you concerned that in 10 years you won't be able to sing a 2-hour show?
No, not at all. Not the way I do right now. I didn't have issues with my vocal cords. It's in White Lion, I simply sang higher than I really was born to.
Okay.
And it only lasted so long. I don't think my puberty was over. So. It's just one of those things. And you know, when I look at it and talk today, it's just one of those things, you know?
Okay, so there's no I'm going to retire in 10 years. You're fine. I mean, you're able to do it as long as you want to do it.
Yeah, sure, sure, exactly.
So what happens to the legacy of White Lion and the music of White Lion? Does the band or you as the go out as the band and do the full rock show, or is that over?
No, that chapter's done.
I
just posted for the 50th time on my Facebook.
That chapter. I'm not talking about a reunion. I'm talking about just going out with either, you know, Troy Patrick Farrell or whoever, and is that done?
Yeah, it basically is. I don't really see it happening, you know, in that way and stuff like that, you know. I just can't see myself going out there because I don't feel it. Okay. And it's just one of those things that when you don't feel it, it would be, you know, the two times I went out there with my Tramps version of White Lion, I had some fun at times. But in reality, I was really kind of like not depressed, but really irritated about myself back in the hotel room after. Says, why did you okay that? Because you don't feel good. I don't feel that I really could deliver myself as the Mike Tramp that was from White Lion. Because there I'm playing the role of Mike Tramp in White Lion.
Right.
Today with an acoustic guitar, I am not playing the Mike Tramp from, you know, in White Lion. I'm playing Mike Tramp that once was in White Lion and now is there today, 52 years old, with an acoustic guitar, telling the stories, giving people the background of the journey, et cetera, et cetera.
Great. Now, would you go back and do an acoustic album with the old White Lion songs? Would you do Wade and Tell Me acoustic and some couple? Like, would you do a live?
I do think so. If it's going to be a live album or if it's going to be a special thing, because I think people are asking that they would like to have these versions.
Yeah,
this is something
absolutely.
That I see very easy and very possible for me to do. So that's definitely on the list and stuff like that. I could also see myself going out with a band playing a little bit more of an acoustic on kind of, in lack of better words, unplugged version, but with some more rhythm behind and another guitar player and bass player and stuff like that. But still keeping it down on just something that seems like we've just turned it down from 11 to 5.
Gotcha. So where do we go in 2013? You're in the States till the end of July or middle of August?
Middle of August, yeah.
And then you said you're going back to Europe. You're doing some European
dates. I'm going back to Indonesia and then, you know, doing some shows there, et cetera, being with my wife and children. And then I'm touring, you know, October, November in Denmark while I'm at the same time recording new stuff, et cetera, et cetera. And then there will definitely be a hiatus and a break until I appear on Monsters of Rock cruise
End of March.
End of March 2014, which also will at the same time give me one more run of the U.S. in the southern states. I'm going to probably do about 2 weeks before the tour and maybe 3 weeks after the tour. So I'll be doing like mid-March to end of April and stuff like that.
With a new album?
Yeah, no, not with a new album. No, I don't see the new album coming out before maybe September 2014.
Okay.
That's not going to be enough time to really release. I think that would be too soon. There's still half of the country that still needs to understand what Cobblestone Street is.
Perfect. So,
I'm not saying that I couldn't be bringing on, you know, what I just spoke about, like the live kind of album, simply just for people to have the music and the songs that I'm playing live.
Yeah, I mean, as a fan of White Lion back in the day, and I saw you open for Kiss and for other bands, I would love to hear an acoustic version of Tell Me or an acoustic version of Wade.
Yeah, I understand that. So does everyone, and so am I. You know, which is what I'm doing. It's just this has just started, and now it. You know what? It's kind of like you've been looking for all these, you know, different sports you like to play now in your later part of your life. And you just realize that, you know, cage fighting is not for you or mountain climbing and stuff like that. And then suddenly you lock in to the one that fits well. And, you know, and it's the same thing. I'm not degrading myself. I'm not like saying I'm dead and stuff like that, because I feel I'm stronger than I am ever. It's just that I don't put any more on my plate than I can eat.
Right.
I don't bring out songs that I don't can sing. At the same time, I'm singing better than I ever sung in my life. And that's simply just because I've come to that part where I feel that the face and the voice and the soul all fits together.
All fits together. Yeah, it sounds great. And boy, you know, people got to go out and get this fabulous album. It's a great album. We'll listen to it.
I appreciate that. I do appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. Is there anything we need to plug? Any websites?
No, I mean, you know, MikeTramp.com and then Facebook, MikeTramp Official, you know.
Twitter?
You know what? I already get in trouble when I just make a direct post on my website where I just say that, you know, like I made my Tramps 10 remindments. And the first one said, there will not be a White Lion reunion ever. And it wasn't necessarily a statement, but I saw 50,000 comments over the last year asking this thing. And I thought I've already said it in 20,000 interviews before. And then number two said, I don't talk to Vito. I don't know what Vito's doing. It's not to piss anyone off, but why you keep asking me that?
Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
I saw that. And it's funny because I do read interviews that that you've given. And the first question is always, well, where's Vito? And it's like, well, How is he supposed to know? I don't know where the people went to high school with.
He doesn't have a website. He doesn't have a Facebook. He doesn't answer people's things, man. And he doesn't want to do anything. And, you know, I don't want the world to think that I'm that this is all I want. I broke the band up for a reason, and I regret, and I even apologize for going out and doing the, you know, the two tours without putting any of the band members down from those things. Those are my friends. But the legacy of White Lion, I sort of almost rather had the memories of the final White Lion show with Vito as my memory than knowing that I played for 50 people in a hellhole somewhere out in Nowhereville. And that was the last stuff I got. So it's just one of those kind of things.
Yeah, so good. So
I appreciate it, Mitch.
Yeah, any last words? I think we've got it all.
It's just that thank you very much for those who support me and those who care. And you know, sometimes, you know, some of us just need to follow what we do.
Yeah, and I'm glad to have you back out there as an artist. I know that you sort of went off and did the rock and roll circus in Denmark, and getting the CD was very difficult. You had to go through
some It's just one of those things.
And it's nice to see you back on U.S. soil. And
it's a great feeling. I'm so pleased. I lived in America for 22 years. I miss it terribly and stuff like that, and so on. So I'm just absorbing every little thing of what I love here while I'm doing this. And at the same time, seeing the country with my own eyes, driving and stuff like that. I mean, in 2 weeks, I'm going to go up. I'm going 400 miles out of the way to visit the battlefield at Little Big Horn, because this is something that has been with me since I was a child. I've written songs about it, et cetera. I'm finally going up there, and I'm so much looking forward to it.
Yeah, it sounds like it's not only a
it's a soul trip. Because I'm sitting there and testing myself of where I want to go in life.
Yeah, it's a great journey. Well, I hope fans join in and follow along. And again, got to go pick this up. It's a great album. Great album. Thank you, Mike.
Peace, anyone. Take care, Mitch.
Talk to you soon.
Thanks, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.